Southern Illinois' home for the best Christian music and the biggest variety. It's local Christian radio, 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine. It's a great song there from Satellites and Sirens. And their song called Tanks. Well, good morning and welcome. It's the Vine Morning Show. Here we are on a Thursday morning. I'm Mark. It's great to have you along this morning. And for those of you watching on our live in-studio camera this morning on our website at WBYN.org, good morning. As well, I have some pastors in the studio with me coming up in just a little while, so stick around for that. And also, we'll have Pastor Tuesday coming up, or Pastor Thursday. Pastor Tuesday? Lost all my date already. Pastor Thursday, and that's the pastor. That's what I'm trying to say. Here it is, Pastor Thursday. Coming up in the 9 o'clock hour, Ask the Pastor. That's what I'm trying to say here. As you'll have a chance to call in, and if you have a question for our pastors this morning, you'll be able to call in at 895-3030 and ask the question on the air just after 9 o'clock. We'll open up the phone lines. If you have a question and you want to email it, you can email it in to mark@wbyn.org, and we'll ask your question on the air, all right? And again, we thank those that are listening to 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine. And also, we thank those that are watching on our in-studio camera on our website at WBYN.org. And Mac is here, and Mac is preparing, and you're not on camera yet, Mac, so. Nothing like live radio, my friend. So there you go. Did you put your makeup on this morning? We'll make sure you did. So there you go.
You got all fancied up today.
Yeah, you did. Hey, tomorrow morning on the Vine Morning Show, Kelly is not going to be able to be here with us tomorrow morning. She's got a prior commitment. So tomorrow morning, we're going to have the debut of the newest Vine intern.
Hey, great.
Tomorrow morning.
That's wonderful. I'm excited to hear
about
that.
Yeah, yeah. And I just posted some information on our Facebook page at WVYN.org. Well, at 90.9 The Vine, our Facebook page, not on our website. But there's a picture of some eyeballs staring at you. A facial shot.
Okay.
And encourage people to tune in tomorrow to find out who it is. Go to our Facebook page and see if you can identify this person. I will give you a clue. This person has never been on before.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
so
never been on.
First time. Person on the radio interning with
yes,
you. Yes, wow,
interning
with us. Wow, that's going to be great. That's exciting.
I'm not going to tell you if it's male or female. You figure it out on our Facebook page.
There you go. That's great. Keep the suspense.
Keep the suspense. Yeah.
Yeah.
This person's coming in tomorrow.
Oh, that's great. That's going to be really good.
Their debut tomorrow. Yeah.
The debut. Yeah. That's fantastic. So that's going to be good.
It'll be fun. It'll be a fun day. Fun day Friday tomorrow with Mark, Jimmy, and our newest intern.
That's perfect. That'll be good.
Yeah, as Kelly will not be able to be here tomorrow. Yeah. So how are you doing, my friend?
Doing really, really good. Had a long day with a few hospital visits yesterday, and stayed all night in Mount Vernon, so got some Huck's coffee here going, and enjoying the day. It's, you know, the sun is shining. It's so beautiful.
And
I love this fall weather.
Right,
this is
right.
A wonderful fall. It's not rainy and you know, just kind of depressing. You know, it's just beautiful, sunny. We rode through Tennessee last weekend on motorcycles.
Oh, yeah. How was that?
It was fantastic. We rode down to the Knoxville area, and instead of taking the interstate, we took all back roads. It took like, you know, 8 or 9 hours to get there, but it was wonderful. We loved it.
Yeah, beautiful drive down through that area.
Oh, it was great. Great. Just clears your mind. Just fantastic.
Yeah. You know, Mac, I was trying to think the other day, when was the last time we've had this type of weather in the middle of November when you stop and think about it, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I was just looking at the forecast.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be in the 60s.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
To me, is perfect weather.
Yeah, I do too. You know, there's a lot of sickness going around, and a lot of people are thinking, I wish it would get really cold. Well, you're going to see some colder temperatures come this weekend at night.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So, yeah, definitely. Like last night, I think we had the freeze advisory.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, I mean, it's definitely gotten cold, but I like that it warms up during the day. That's great.
Yeah. I had a little frost on the windshield this morning.
I did too.
Did you really? Had a little frost on the
windshield. Old church van was frosted over.
It was frosted over, yeah. All right. Well, Pastor Cory will be here, and I do have some questions for Ask the Pastor
this
morning.
Yeah, looking forward to that.
Hour, so. And also, have you ever been to England before, Mac, or have a desire to go?
Never have. I've just been to Asia and South America, not Europe.
Well, we're going to look at some words that mean very different things in England and America. I tell you what, let's do that right now.
Sure.
We've got a little bit of time.
That sounds
so
like fun.
Let's do that, and then we'll get started here when Pastor Cory gets here in just a little bit. Bird, B-I-R-D. You know, in the United States, a bird is, well, an animal with feathers that tweets.
Uh-huh.
But in England, a bird is often used to describe a young female.
Oh,
yeah.
I didn't know that. That's hilarious.
Well, it's similar to the way young women are referred to as chicks in America.
Yeah, you know? Okay.
But, you know, be wary of calling your boss's daughter a bird, you know. That might not be a good thing. You know?
May not take that right.
That's right. Right, that's right. All right, trainer, T-R-A-I-N-E-R.
Uh-huh.
Now, saying you need a new trainer in America means something quite different than it does in England. Here, trainers are fitness experts who can help you work out. Do you know what they're called in England?
No, I'm clueless on that one.
Trainers are just another name for sneakers or tennis shoes.
Really? Wow, yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. A jumper. Now, a jumper in America, the term jumper typically involves maybe somebody who's jumping or going to jump from one building or bridge.
Uh-huh.
Now, the meaning could not be more different in Great Britain, where jumper is the name given to a knitted top.
Oh.
Whereas in America, it's called a sweater.
Oh, and they call it a jumper. Wow.
A jumper, yeah. Now, casket. You know, in America, a casket is also called a coffin, right,
yeah.
Mac? But in Great Britain, on the other hand, a casket has a completely different meaning. It refers to a small, often antique box used to store jewelry or trinkets.
Oh, wow.
Now, if a casket isn't for you, check out. So there you go.
Yeah.
It's called a jewelry box.
Yeah,
here.
That's great.
Yeah, a comforter. Here's another one. In, you know, informing a Londoner that you look or that you like to snuggle with your comforter every night may result in some strange looks.
Comforter.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Unless you're a baby. In the U.S., a comforter is a quilted bedspread. But in England, a comforter is used to describe a baby's pacifier.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Okay. Here's one. A pants. P-A-N-T-S.
Uh-huh.
Now, telling a British person you got your pants dirty could raise some eyebrows.
Oh, really?
All right. Now, in America, of course, pants are clothing that covers you from your waist to your ankles, right?
Uh-huh.
All right. All right. You ready for this one?
Yeah, this is going to be...
All right. You ready for this one, right? Okay. In England, the term pants is another word for undergarments.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, that's...
All right. A couple more. A boot. Now, if a Londoner tells you he locks something in his boot... You may look at him quizzically, you know, like, oh, what are you talking about? Yet, don't be alarmed. While in America, a boot is a type of footwear. In England, the term is used to refer to a trunk of a car.
Yes, I knew that one.
You knew that one?
Yep.
You knew that one. All right.
That's good.
All right. Now, one more. Here's a good one. In one country, they're used to straighten your teeth, braces.
Uh-huh.
But in the other, in England, they're used to hold up your pants.
Oh, Braces. Is that like suspenders
or
something?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. In Great Britain, but in Great Britain, it refers to suspenders in Great Britain.
Braces.
Braces.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, braces in Great Britain are suspenders.
Wow. That is really neat.
Anyway.
The boot, you know, they call the boot and the bonnet. The bonnet is the front hood.
Oh, okay.
That's what they call the front part of the vehicle is the bonnet. And, yeah, that's something else.
The bonnet in England is the front of the car.
The front hood.
Okay,
yeah,
the
boot is the trunk.
Yeah, I wonder why they called it bonnet.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know. The boot and the bonnet.
All right, well, interesting. That's interesting. I thought you might enjoy
that.
Yeah,
that's great. I love that.
All right. Hey, we'll come back in a little bit with Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory. We'll find out what you guys have on your heart to share this morning, and then we'll get to our Ask the Pastor segment just after 9 this morning.
Looking forward to that.
All right, sounds good, as we'll continue here on the Vine Morning Show on this Thursday morning. Right now, it's time for a moment in God's Word with Max Hooper, underwritten by Crawford Plumbing in Woodlawn.
Crawford Plumbing, LLC in Woodlawn is licensed, bonded, insured, and ready to serve your household and business plumbing needs. From leaky faucets to complete plumbing systems and repair, Crawford Plumbing in Woodlawn is a full-service plumbing company. They can be reached at 618-242-3360. Crawford Plumbing in Woodlawn is a proud underwriting sponsor of Real Life Radio.
It's time now for a moment in God's Word with your host, Max Hooper.
Hello, everyone. You know, sometimes I look through a Bible called the Life Recovery Bible. This Bible is specifically geared for folks that have an addiction. It could be drugs or alcohol or even anger. A Bible like this may well be used by Alcohol Anonymous. If you face any of these struggles, please consider getting yourself such a help Bible and joining AA. God shows us paths that lead to help, and His Word can win the battle. You know, many times things just happen. Sometimes because of bad choices we make, and sometimes they just happen. There are times in our life when right and wrong stand in stark contrast to each other. Even when we know that things should be changed, we don't act, even though we feel we know what is right and what is wrong. Things can move so fast and change without notice that we feel powerless and hopeless. There's a great story in 1 Samuel about David fighting the great and powerful Goliath. The account is found in chapter 17. I hope you don't mind me paraphrasing in order to get some of the details in our short time span. Goliath was a monster of a man who came out daily to challenge the Israeli army. He was so large and formidable that the army would shrink back as if to run away. David convinced the king to let him fight the giant in his own way. In chapter 17, verses 45 and 46, David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword, spear, and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I will strike you down." Well, David did slay the fearsome Goliath with his stone and sling. Just as we can conquer all that confronts us, even though the odds may seem overwhelming, God has answers for all that we see and do not understand. Here the Israeli army saw a giant that no one could conquer. Yet out of the crowd came David, only a child, but with the strength of God at his side. A huge army had been stopped and without the will to move forward until David confidently moved into the battle to save the army from defeat. Certainly are times when we need courage and God's helping hand to lead us against what we think is certain defeat. We need to change our life and follow our Lord by following His Word. In the Life Recovery Bible is a prayer I would like to give you. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Well, thanks for being with us today. This is Max Hooper. Have a great day.
You've been listening to A Moment in God's Word, a daily devotion hosted by Southern Illinois sports legend Max Hooper.
If I saw you on the street, and you said, "Come and follow me," but I had to give up everything, all I once held dear, and all of my dreams, would I love you enough to let go? Or would my love run dry when you ask for my life?
become unconsuming. Forgetting what the world.
Sidewalk Profits from Real Life Radio, 105.5 and 90.9 The Pine. You can have me. Sports on the way, and then after that, we'll do the weather, and then after the weather, it'll be Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory. Coming up in the Vine Morning Show on a Pastor Thursday, right here, Real Life Radio.
Real Life Radio is thankful for the financial partnership we have with Greenwald & Sons Construction in Wayne City and in Mount Vernon. They specialize in residential and commercial construction and remodeling. They have a long list of satisfied customers spanning over 38 years. Whether it's a church addition, business expansion, or new home construction, Greenwald & Sons Construction of Wayne City and Mount Vernon are experts that you can depend on. Their phone number is 895-2044, and we thank them for their support of local Christian radio.
Hi, this is Tim Kuntz, and I'd just like to invite you to come to Keene's Christian Church in Keene's, Illinois. Great family of believers there. We have Sunday school at 9:30 on Sunday morning, and then worship is at 10:30, and then we have an evening service on Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. We have youth groups on Wednesday night. We have a website that you might check out at keeneschristian.com, but we'd like for you to come and worship with us, especially if you don't have a church home. Keene's Christian Church in Keene's, Illinois.
The following is a real-life story from Trinity Debt Management.
I had numerous credit cards, and I was struggling with paying them off, so I made the call.
If you're in debt and you need help, call Trinity at 1-800-606-4260.
The people at Trinity are very friendly. They will do whatever you need them to do in order for you to feel better about being in a very difficult place.
If your debt has you down, call Trinity at 1-800-606-4260.
Time now for Hey Howard and the 1 minute feature this morning, underwritten by Fairfield Banking Company.
Hi, this is Ashley DeVoy with the Fairfield Banking Company. We've been strongly rooted in this area since 1892. Our foundation is strong, and we offer a unique checking account for customers 50 and older. It's called the 1892 Founders Club Checking, and it puts your money to work with interest paid on balances of $1,000 or more. You've worked hard to build a strong financial foundation for yourself, and now it's time to reap the rewards, including free checks and paper statements. Learn more about the 1892 Founders Club Checking account, available at the Fairfield Banking Company, 915 Commerce Drive, member FDIC, and equal housing lender.
Helping you to be a wise money manager, here's financial expert Howard Dayton with today's question. Hey Howard, 3 years ago we bought and moved into a fixer-upper home on the water to renovate and sell. We're about to sell it for $125,000 in profit. Is there any way we can avoid capital gains tax?
Well, I've got really good news for you. There is a provision in the tax code for what is called the capital gains exclusion for homeowners. And to qualify for the exclusion, you must have owned and lived in your home as your principal residence for at least 2 of the past 5 years before the sale, so you qualify. An individual can make a profit of $250,000 and a married couple $500,000 of profit without paying any capital gains tax. Well, want to learn more about handling money God's way? Visit compassone.org.
Great Christian music that your whole family can enjoy.
I wanna do. My mouth just keeps on running, but I never follow through. I heard that true religion is love with hands and feet. I wanna find my own way to reach a world in need.
Good morning, everyone. Time now to check sports on this Thursday morning. Junior high girls basketball action last night. The Oil Belt Conference Tournament. The semifinal game that was played Tuesday night. Selmaville was defeated by Willow Grove 35-20. Willow Grove advances to tonight's championship. And they play Central City. Selmaville will play for third place. That will be at 6:45 against Kale. Kale tonight. All right, that's it. 6:45 tonight. Selmaville and Kale playing for third place. Centralia beat KC Middle School Tuesday 56-14. Centralia runs their record to 8-0. And on the schedule tonight, junior high girls basketball at 6. Edwards County will be at Wayne City, New Hope at Sisney, Jasper at St. Joe's, and Hamilton County in Fairfield. Junior high boys basketball from Tuesday, Centralia beat Franklin Park 54-38. And Odin beat Patoka 55-44. Odin will play Raccoon tonight. And also tonight, 6 o'clock, Allendale at Jeff and junior high boys basketball. Carmi at Albion. Wayne City will be at Bethel, and Fairfield will be in Florida tonight for junior high boys basketball. Fairfield High School Fall Awards Night will be held tonight at 6 o'clock, and awards will be given in cheerleading, cross country, girls tennis, golf, volleyball, football. It'll all get underway in the high school gym at 6. Winter sports meetings will take place following at approximately 6:45 to 7 for athletes and parents in the sports of basketball, wrestling, and cheerleading. Now, Edwards County High School will conduct a Meet the Team night on tonight, and parents will be given the opportunity to take photos and to see some of the work done by the girls and boys basketball team in preparation for this year, and cheerleaders as well. Now, parents and fans are encouraged to attend the night activities. Now, admission to this event is a non-perishable food item. All food collected will be donated to a local food pantry. And meet the team's night tonight. Introduction of all players and cheerleaders will begin at 6:50. The scrimmage for girls basketball at 7 o'clock tonight. The boys basketball will scrimmage at 7:20. And there will be a sports boosters meeting immediately following the preview in the high school cafeteria there at Edwards County High School tonight. Well, let's check some national sports this morning. In the NFL, Thursday night football action tonight, Cleveland will take on Baltimore in Baltimore tonight. That'll be at 7:25. NCAA football scores from last night. Bowling Green beat Akron 38-28, and Toledo beat Northern Illinois 31-24. Now on the schedule for tonight, number 17, North Carolina, will be playing Duke. University Louisiana Lafayette taking on Georgia Southern. And number 15, Utah, will take on Arizona State. That's in college football for tonight. NBA basketball scores from Wednesday. In overtime, Indiana beat Philadelphia 122-115. New York winner over Brooklyn 110-96. Minnesota beat Orlando 123-107. Washington, a winner over Boston 118-93. Charlotte beat Utah 104-98. Atlanta 115, Chicago Bulls 107. Toronto beat Oklahoma City 112-102. It was Phoenix beating Detroit 107-100. Houston beat San Antonio last night 101-99. Golden State a winner over Dallas 116-95. Steph Curry had 24 points in that game.
Underwriting on the Vine and is provided by Embroidery
Clippers,
and more.
They beat Portland last night. The Clippers did over Portland. They were winners 111-80. In the National Hockey League, last night in St. Louis at Scott Trade Center, took overtime, but the Chicago Blackhawks beat the St. Louis Blues 2-1. It was Columbus over Anaheim in overtime 3-2, and Ottawa beat Buffalo in a shootout last night 2-1. Now St. Louis will be in Nashville tonight to take on the Nashville Predators at 7 o'clock, and the Blackhawks are off. They will host Washington Friday night at 7:30. That's Check Sports for you on this Thursday morning. I'm Mark Wells reporting.
Underwriting on the Vine is provided by Embroidery and More in Fairfield. Embroidery and More specializes in custom embroidery, custom heat transfers for your reunion, school, and church groups, as well as baby items, wedding gifts, and Americana decor. Their hours are 9 to 5 Monday through Friday, Saturdays 9 to 1. You can also like them on Facebook. Embroidery and More is located at 107 Southeast 2nd Street in Fairfield, and their phone number is 847-5027.
Time now to check the area weather forecast, and this morning it's underwritten by Home Source Warehouse in Mount Vernon.
Monthly financial support of local Christian radio is provided by Home Source Warehouse in Mount Vernon. Located 4 miles north of Mount Vernon on Route 37, Home Source Warehouse offers a warehouse full of quality furniture and mattresses with legendary service. Open Thursday and Friday, 10 to 6, Saturday, 10 to 3. You can find them on Facebook, and their website is homesourcewarehouse.net. Their phone number is 204-5515. Home Source Warehouse, where style is affordable.
And here's that forecast for the Vine listening area on this Thursday. Beautiful day all the way through Sunday. Clear skies all the way through Sunday, according to the forecast. High today of 64, high tomorrow of 60, high Saturday of 54, and then the high on church Sunday of 60. Right now, temperatures in the area starting to warm up some. Flora and Salem at 46, McLeansboro, Carmi at 43, Mount Vernon at 40. Fairfield at 40, and in Wayne City right now it's 41.
90.9 The Vine.
And we welcome you back. It's the Vine Morning Show on this Thursday morning. I'm Mark, and again, we thank you for listening to 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine. And if you're tuned in, our live in-studio camera this morning on our website at wbyn.org. Good morning, and thanks for tuning in this morning, as it's Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory in the studio. Guys, good morning, and thanks for coming in this morning, guys.
Yeah, good morning, sir.
Good morning. It's good to be here.
Yeah, it's good to see you guys. And again, we're a reminder, we do have some questions emailed in to us. And if you have a question you'd like to email in, email it to Mark at wbyn.org. Or just after 9 o'clock, we'll ask the pastor, and we'll open up the phone lines at 895-3030 if you have a question for Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory. And we'll do that just after 9 o'clock, guys. But it's good to see you and welcome in today on this beautiful Thursday. And what's on your heart, gentlemen?
Those questions have been so good, too.
Yeah, they have.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
So, yeah, keep sending them in. Call in here after 9. Talk to us. We'd love to hear from you. Email them, whatever works best for you. But so what's on our heart? What's on my heart today? I mean, we can't ignore what's just happened in the country on Tuesday.
That's right.
You know, I don't know if all the listeners out there watched any of the coverage, but headlines I saw was everybody reporting, even from the beginning of the night, this historic election, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, it's a big deal. My only concern is, no matter which way it went, no matter who, you know, you voted for or what, is people kind of just get this sigh of relief that, oh, it's over. And the church cannot do that.
Right. That's exactly right.
It's not, you know, the things that we believe, the things that we hold, the things that we, you know, I believe our Constitution stands for, there's some big things that need to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, just because we've elected a representative, a president, somebody to go do that, we can't just breathe a sigh of relief and then just kind of walk away from it. We need to fast and pray more now, like more than ever before.
You know, I'm glad you mentioned that, Cory, because I talked to somebody night before last, and they said, you know, we needed to pray for the election, but now we need to pray more and more than ever.
Because, more than ever.
Yeah, because of, you know, the situation is still unknown, you know, at this point in time. It's going to take some time for an adjustment, but we still need to pray more and more. Our prayers need to be more stronger now than what they were during the election.
Yeah.
Right. I think this is just the first step, you know, for many. And, you know, as a lot of believers have been praying for this to happen, but it's not, I think a lot of times as believers, whenever we feel like something good happens, we let our guard down.
Right.
And we just back off.
Look at Israel.
Yeah,
that's what they
did
over and over again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they did. I mean, it's you know, I mean, look at that example to see. You know, it's like, as you look through the book of Judges, I love Judges. You know, it's like it's a restoration book. It's a like a redemptive book. You know, you see where the Israelites would fall away from God, and then they would, get themselves in a mess and cry out to God, and God would rescue them, but they would continue to fall again over and over and over. And it's important to to keep our focus as believers and continue to be an example, you know, and even in loving. You know, one thing that I've seen a lot on Facebook from believers is this is not a time to be, you know, mean or hateful, you know, in our opinions or something like that. It's a time to be loving but firm.
Yeah, I like what you just said there, loving but firm, because it's not a time to back down either.
Exactly.
You know, I'll bring up the issue of abortion.
Yeah,
and I would think we all agree in this room.
Oh yeah,
that abortion is murder. You know, I mean, we can sugarcoat it however people want to.
Right.
There should really be no reason why the House, the Senate, and the President could not pass a bill to defund Planned Parenthood.
Exactly.
And some of these organizations that have been caught in criminal acts of doing things. And, you know, maybe I'm just ignorant, but I don't know what else they provide that the local hospital couldn't provide.
Yeah, and there will be some things that as a nation we may never get back, but I believe that we are going to get some things back. You know, the tide's going to turn. But one thing that was really stirring in my heart in prayer yesterday is a lot of believers focus on being a light, you know, and to where, you know, we need to be a light, we need to love and all of this, but we're also called to be salt. And, you know, when you, even Jesus himself said that salt without savor is worthless.
Right.
And it's to be trampled on, you know, thrown out in the dirt and be trampled on. And, that really says a lot about the church, because I did a study one time. I was the Lord put on my heart to preach on this, and I thought, well, what causes salt to lose its savor? Does it just break down? It doesn't. Salt is a very strong compound, and they like each other.
Mm-hmm.
And salt doesn't just fall apart and break down. It has to be either watered down or mixed with something
else
to lose its savor.
Wow.
And that's something so important, because believers, for us to lose our savor, we either water it down or mix it with something else to try to dilute it. And that's not what we are called to do. The truth is the truth, no matter how relevant it is to society. The truth is the truth, no matter how much people don't like to hear it. But the truth is what sets people free. That's what the Word of God says.
That's right.
And so be firm. It's possible to be loving. I love to call it velvet steel.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Soft but firm.
Yeah.
You know, and it is important. And pray for our nation. Don't let your guard down.
Right. Because some of these things that we're facing, I mean, they're not going to change just overnight.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, the financial issues we're facing, you know, I don't know if you guys ever talk about that on Tuesdays or something with Laura, but I mean, you know, the financial issues that we have going on in the country, you know, with the Fed setting interest rates near zero and the stimulus, and when you take that away, or if they stop that, those things aren't going to just fix overnight.
Right.
You know, and there could be some difficulty in times ahead in order to right the ship. And a ship as big as the United States, you can't turn it around just on a dime always. And so we have got to pray, and we've got to. I like what you talked about, loving and truth. And I heard an individual talk about this just on the principles of liberty and freedom, is we've got to educate people one person at a time. Same thing applies to the Christian worldview, you know, and I have a Christian biblical worldview. I'm not ashamed of that. I think I'm proud to have a biblical worldview, to know history, to know what God says about things, to understand God's created order, and to see how the world works from God's point of view. That's a good thing to know.
Oh yeah.
And but we have to share that with other people.
Yeah.
One person at a time.
Yes.
And not be afraid to have those conversations wherever we're at, and do it in a loving way, but be firm about it.
Don't get into your emotions. I think that's where we can get into our emotions and start a fight, you know, you know, kind of get over too far, and, you know, to where we lose that love and begin to be hurtful. It's easy to do that. It's easy when your opinion is not widely accepted by society, to feel like you have to defend that with almost like a, you know what I mean, like a negative kind of force.
Right.
But just be firm. And the thing is, God is so faithful. When you stand for God, He always backs you up. You know, and just like a couple weeks ago at our church, the Lord put on my heart to talk about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Yeah.
And, you know, God, it's so great because they stood for God, and they stood against all of society.
Right.
They stood against the king. They, you know, they said, we will not bow. We stand for what our God teaches. We stand for what our God says, and we will worship our God alone.
Right.
Even unto death. And the interesting thing is, the Lord didn't show up when they said that. Mm-hmm. The Lord didn't show up. You know, I mean, I'm sure he, you know, they had this boldness and they knew God is with them, but it's like Jesus right there next to them showed up in the fire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when they stood to even to face death, you know, the Lord was with them. And that's what I want us to understand. You know, it doesn't mean that everything's going to be okay. You know, it doesn't mean that everything is going to be fine and dandy and perfect, because there is going to be resistance.
Absolutely there is. And we've got to be willing to stand up. And you know, I believe there may come a point, and the point may be now, where we have to practice civil disobedience. And that is what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did.
Yep.
I mean, he's just saying, and Daniel, and you go to the New Testament, Peter and John did the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they said, you know, we're going to do what God says. We're not going to do it violently. We're not going to do this, but we're going to stand up for truth, it come what may. You know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were raised to before that happened, they were already promoted in the kingdom.
Yeah, yeah.
That had happened after Daniel's fast and all this stuff.
Yeah.
The king had promoted that group of Hebrew young men, and they were willing to walk away from that.
Yeah.
In order to stand for what they believe.
Yeah.
In order to stand for biblical principles. And that is a question I think people need to ask themselves now.
Yeah.
How far are you willing to live out your faith? When it begins to cost you something, and when it begins to be a place where you're going to have to, you know, walk away from some things, are you willing to do it?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, how important are things to us, you know, our things? And you know, even in these last days, I want us to be, even with my son, he's 18. And he's graduating high school. He's going to be leaving around June to go to college in another state. And one thing the Lord has put on my heart over the last few years is teaching him the Word of God, you know, teaching him character and all of that, but focusing so much on being led by the Holy Spirit, mm-hmm. being led by the voice of God, because in these last days, we have to know who our God is. We have to know his voice. Jesus said, my sheep know my voice. And you know, we have got to remember that. We've got to look to God and see. And all this goes down to, church, don't let your guard down.
Mm-hmm.
Keep praying, you know. Keep that before you. And pray for the president, whether you agree with what happened or not. You know, there's so many different opinions going around and so many things. But the thing about it is, this is still and will be one nation under God. Mm-hmm. We are one nation under God, and we have a plan from God Almighty for this nation.
Oh, I believe that it's something, you know, it's something I think that God was with the founding fathers, and they were not perfect people.
Right.
People want to hold the people to these pedestals. You study them. Those guys were not perfect. They said some theological things that if you read some of what George Washington said and Thomas Jefferson, you'll be like, oh my goodness, what was wrong with those people?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But God moves through imperfect people.
Yeah.
I mean, he worked through, I believe he worked through them.
Yeah.
And what are we going to do with this gift that we've been given?
Yeah. Yeah.
What are we going to do with it? Are we going to value, you know, like what we just talked about? Are we going to value our comfort more than we value the truth? Are we going to value, you know, our place in society more than we value biblical principles?
Yeah, that's true.
Are we willing to stand up and be uncomfortable to stand up for the rights of the lives of the unborn?
Or fall back in the silent shadows?
Right.
You know,
just be
quiet. Tuesday, many people came out of the shadows.
You know, I think, wasn't it, guys, and I, you know, I was reading a statistic or listening to a statistic. They said this was the most that the evangelical Christians came out and voted in a decade.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know,
and we need to see we have a voice, and it's not over. We're, you know, I love Ecclesiastes, where it talks about time. You know, there's a time for this, there's a time for that. And, you know, for believers, there's a time to be in the prayer closet, but there's also time to step out and take a stand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And to put action to your prayers.
I love this. I love to listen to Martin Luther King Jr. preach some of his old tapes. You know, I might not have agreed with some of his... He was kind of more on the social programs, different stuff, and you have a different view of this or that, but I think his principles of standing up for racial equality was incredible.
Yes.
To bring racial unity was incredible, not to see beyond color. So I love his sermons.
Yes.
And I love this. I love this quote, and this is what we're talking about. Listen to this. I listen to this sermon every once in a while. This is Martin Luther King Jr., "You may be 38 years old, as I happen to be, and one day some great opportunity stands before you and calls you to stand up for some great principle, some great issue, some great cause, and you refuse to do it because you are afraid. You refuse to do it because you want to live longer. You're afraid that you'll lose your job, or you're afraid that you will be criticized, or that you'll lose your popularity, and you're afraid that somebody will stab you or shoot at you or bomb your house, so you refuse to take the stand. Well, you may go on and live until you're 90, but you're just as dead at 38 as you would be at 90, and the cessation of breathing in your life is but the belated announcement of an earlier death of the spirit." Wow.
That's awesome. Wow. I like that.
That's incredible, isn't it?
I like that.
But I look at my generation, and I look at, you know, other people, and I see that they're afraid to take a stand.
Yeah.
They're afraid to say something publicly. They're afraid to take a stand against abortion. They're afraid to talk about the biblical view of homosexuality, of why it's wrong, of how it goes against God's created order. They're afraid to do these things because they're afraid of some political backlash, or they're afraid the government's going to do this, or they'll be labeled this or labeled that. I like, you're already dead. You've already ceased living. Yeah. You've already given up.
Yeah.
We can't give up.
Yeah. And that's actually one thing we're going to talk about in the questions about being dead to self and alive in Christ. What does that mean? You know, because when you realize that God is, you know, this saying, when you realize that God is all that you have, then that's when you realize that's all you need.
That's all you need. And you know? I guess the big thing I just, you know, from the beginning is what, like you said, they turned out in massive numbers, more than that they've seen in the past. But what is going on is about more than voting. Yeah. If the church can understand that what is happening and what needs to happen is about more than casting a vote. It's about taking a stand. It's about letting your voice be heard in love, but being firm in it. It's about winning and talking to people in a loving manner, in a conversation one-on-one. Yeah. It's about, you know, living a biblical worldview and living it out. Living it out loud. I can't stop everything the government does. I can't, you know, do everything on my own, but I can do something. I can do my part. You know what I mean? I can.
Yeah. I mean, this is the beginning of a movement, and I want to challenge everybody out there. This is a challenge from Pastor Mac. I'm sure you'll jump on board with me here. I want to challenge you today to find somebody that's not a believer, somebody that's struggling in their walk with the Lord, you know, that may be what we call a backslidden Christian or something. But I want to challenge you to be a voice in their life. Ask the Lord for one person, just one. I mean, because I think we can get overwhelmed by the whole, like, we need to win the lost, we need to win the lost, and we seem to group the lost into this big mass that maybe seems unreachable, but it starts with one person.
That's right.
And so that's what I want to challenge everybody listening today with all of my heart to reach out to one today. Reach out to one and pray for them. Be a voice in their life. Give them the truth. Be bold, but be loving.
People want that too.
Yeah,
they want to know.
They're searching.
We were just that. A group of guys went. We went and watched a movie Friday, and we went to eat afterwards. And we were sitting there. Here's a simple thing. I told the church, you can do this. When the waitress or the waiter brings you your food, and they say, "Is there anything I can get for you?" Just say, "Well, no, we're good, but we're getting ready to pray for the food. Is there anything we could pray for you over?"
Yes.
And
good.
I mean, that is something that's simple. It's something that they will appreciate.
Yeah.
And you just tell them you love them, God loves them, Jesus loves them, and pray for their need. And, I mean, that shocks them.
Yeah. I want to tell you a story. My wife and I were on a date at Rare in Mount Vernon here. And when we went to the restaurant, you know, we were eating and stuff and just, you know, having a good time, just taking a break together, enjoying each other. And we don't get dates very often because we've got young kids, mm-hmm. you know, and so we had a date, we were talking and stuff, and all of a sudden our waitress came up and she had, her arm was in a sling and she was kind of struggling with that. And my wife looked over and she's like, "Oh, did you hurt your arm?" And she said, "Yeah, it's been really hurt, you know, blah, blah, blah. I've got all this pain in it and all that." And I was like, "Okay." And the lady walked off and Jen looked at me and she goes, "We've got to pray for her." Mm. And I was like, man, because it's like a wide open place, you know, and there's a lot of people around and your flesh doesn't like that, mm-hmm. but your spirit jumps on the inside and said, this is a chance, you know, to pray for someone. So she came back over and my wife said, you've got that pain in your arm. And she said, yeah. And my wife and I both were talking to her and basically we just said, we want to pray for you. Is that okay? And she goes, yeah. And it was just kind of awkward, you know, but we prayed for her right there. I mean, we put our hands on her and we prayed for her right there. And God healed this girl.
Wow.
Yeah. Immediately the pain left her arm and she began to cry and had to walk off because she was crying and sure. overcome, you know, and excuse me. And she came back later and said that she used to go to church. And she used to live for the Lord, and she had fallen away from Him, and felt like that she had messed up so much that God didn't love her anymore, and that He wouldn't take her back. And we got to witness her. God loved her so much that He healed her right there.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
And she rededicated her life, you know, while she was serving us food.
That's what the church is supposed to be.
Awesome. That should be yeah, every day.
That should be every day. I love this. I know we're probably getting ready to go to break, and. She posted on Facebook, posted it public, so I'll share it with everybody. Her name's Kirsten Melton, and she wrote this about the vote, but then she said this, I also understand that American Christians cannot rely on our government to do its job. It is up to each individual to quit being self-serving and inwardly focused and begin doing the work of Jesus, to give, to serve, and most importantly, to love, beyond society's limits, beyond personal comfort, and beyond expectations. That is where souls will be won. That is where the battle is waged. That is where the game changes. It is time to step up, find what God has made you passionate about, and step into it. No one else can do your job. The American Christian can sleep no longer. That's
Praise
it,
God.
Man. That's
man,
it.
I love it.
That's it. Walking
Wake
out.
Up.
The waiters, the waitresses, the people at the gas station, your family members, your neighbors. It's time to step
it's
up, church.
To step up. Yeah. It is.
Amen.
Yeah. It's time to, you know, as I saw a post, it's time for the church to wake up.
Yes. Wake up.
Wake up, church.
You know, and that's all it is. That's all we have to do. All right, guys. Hey, we're going to come back here in just a few moments right after Uncommon Moments with Tony Dungy and his wife, and we'll open up the phone lines here in just a little bit at 895-3030 as it'll be our Ask the Pastor segment with Pastor Mac and Pastor Corey when we come back as we're into the 9 o'clock hour. And more to come. The Vine Morning Show continues on this Thursday right here at Real Life Radio.
This is your home for best Christian music.
WVYN, Blueford, Wayne City, Fairfield, Mount Vernon.
And now on translator, W288CO Centralia, broadcasting at 105.5.
A service of Real Life Radio Foundation.
The best Christian music, 90.9.
Today, as she slips in, trying to fade into the faces, the girl's teasing laughter is carrying farther than they know, farther than they know. But if we are the body,
why is his love not showing this?
Casting Crowns from Real Life Radio, 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine, if we are the body. It is 9:07. We'll come back and we'll have Ask the Pastor segment coming up right here on The Vine. But right now it's time for Uncommon Moments with Tony Dungy and his wife Lauren Dungy this morning. It's underwritten by Fairfield National Bank.
As a financial advisor, John Reynolds is well-versed in the best practices of financial planning. But as a local, raised in Wayne County, he's more than experienced with the unique challenges you face every day. After growing up here, he's now returned, investing back into the community that contributed to his success, passionate and committed to helping you with yours. FNB Asset Management. We're here to help.
This is Uncommon Moments with Super Bowl winning coach Tony Dungy and his wife Lauren on their uncommon marriage adventure. Available now in paperback.
I didn't start off as a great coach, but I got better as I progressed and as I learned a little bit more. I also, when I was 25 years old, I had no previous coaching experience. I think it's the same way in being a husband or being a parent. At the end of the day, men, that's how we're going to be judged. How is your wife doing? How is she blossoming? How is your family doing? It's not whether you're the boss or whether you're in charge. How is your wife and your children doing? I was 25 years old. I'd never been a coach before, didn't have any experience. It's the same thing when we come into marriage and becoming a husband.
The Uncommon Marriage Adventure by Tony and Lauren Dungy. Now available in softcover from Tyndale Momentum. More info at CoachDungy.com.
Good morning and welcome back. It's the Vine Morning Show. Here we are on a Thursday morning. I'm Mark. It's great to have you along. If you're listening to 105.5 or 90.9 The Vine, thank you this morning. If you're watching our in-studio camera this morning on our website at WVYN.org, we thank you for tuning in, so to speak, this morning here on The Vine, either on the radio or on the television. And Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory with me this morning, and we'll get to our Ask the Pastor segment in a moment. But I want to remind you, programming reminder, tomorrow morning is Fun Day Friday on The Vine Morning Show. And we have a lot of fun on Friday. Jimmy will join me in the studio. Kelly is usually here, but she's not going to be able to make it tomorrow due to a prior commitment. So tomorrow we're going to have the newest Vine intern with us tomorrow. And this person has never been on with us before. Brand new venture for this person. And you can go to our Facebook page at Real Life Radio 90.9 The Vine, and it'll have a little detail on there. And there's some eyeballs that are staring at you. And you figure out who it might be, all right, tomorrow. That's a challenge for you to figure out who this person is. I'm not going to tell you if it's male or female. Go to our Facebook page, Real Life Radio 90.9 The Vine, and figure out who our newest Vine intern is. And tune in tomorrow to find out who this person is tomorrow morning. It's Fun Day Friday. We'll have a movie theme song for you and a Friday riddle for you to call in and identify, and some cool prizes as well. That's coming up tomorrow morning on Fun Day Friday right here on The Vine with Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory this morning. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
And as you can see right above Mac's head and in between Mac and Cory, more on Mac's side, the Ask the Pastor segment sign where you can call in at 895-3030 and ask Pastor Mac, Pastor Cory a question. And if you want to, email us a question to mark@wvyn.org. And you don't have to email it today. You can email it anytime. If you want to, email it today or anytime during the week. And we'll save the question for Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory. It's our Ask the Pastor segment. And if you have a question you want to ask, if we're in the middle of one, we'll answer your phone call and call us up at 895-3030, 895-3030. And guys, we have one that's been emailed into us, and we didn't get to this one last week. And this is one from Jeff, who lives in Fairfield. And his question is, I just recently became a new Christian and have many bad habits, and I'm working very hard to change my lifestyle. But one thing I'm struggling to do is give up smoking. What does the Bible say about defiling the body? There's your first question this morning, guys, from Jeff in Fairfield.
Yeah, Jeff, thank you for asking this question. Again, I just want to say that, like, you know, for us here doing this, it's just something the Lord put on our heart to answer questions that may be on your heart. Not that we know everything or even claim, you know, I mean, just humbly, I know there's a lot of questions that we may have, but with this about smoking, You know, for me personally, I know, like in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, I know that Paul's writing about sexual immorality and things, but I really like what he talks about the body being a temple of the Holy Spirit. And it's important to realize that we are supposed to take care of our bodies. I mean, it's very important to take care of what God has given us, you know what I mean? And I believe that with smoking or defiling your body or something like that, you know, it is important to protect it. I don't think that smoking will send you to hell necessarily, but I believe you need to be sensitive to the Lord. If he's convicting you about it, then his grace is sufficient to help you kick the habit. And it's a matter of you wanting to stop smoking, you know, if you have that desire. And if for some reason, I remember that when I first got born again, I struggled with smoking. Because the reason it was such a struggle for me is because I really enjoyed to smoke. I loved smoking. It was really hard to quit because it was like a relaxation thing for me, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was very hard for me to quit because not because God wasn't helping me. It was because my flesh didn't want to quit. Mm-hmm. And finally, I asked God because I was ashamed of it. And I asked the Lord, I said, you know, I realized that I am hurting my body and I feel like it's time to quit. And so, God, I ask you to help me. And mm-hmm. he did. And I threw him out and quit smoking.
You know, a lot of people too, guys, in that, you know, they do it for a reason, because maybe of depression, maybe they're going through a situation, and it's very hard to give up. But
right.
But there are different ways that can be intervened in helping you to quit smoking.
I think we should. I think more than just smoking, it applies to any area. Anything. If something that has control over you.
Yes.
Uh-huh. You know, and this is one thing that I've struggled with and I'm working on getting better to, is not just, you know, not just cigarettes, but anything. So, you know, a lot of people in the church and a lot of people from pulpits will get up and they'll talk about the drugs, alcohol, the smoking that harms your body and your body's a temple, and the sexual immorality to stay away from it. But another thing I think we should probably talk about sometimes is food.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, I guess, you know, I don't want to.
Yeah.
I think sometimes I don't want to let food control me either, because, you know, we turn to that, you know, to relieve stress or whatever. So I do believe, you know, that passage that Mac just referenced in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, it says plainly, you know, for you are the temple of the living God. You are the God's temple. This is 2 Corinthians 6.
Okay. Yeah.
2 Corinthians, there's probably 1 Corinthians 2, 2 Corinthians 6.
Yeah, it's
6,
in 1 Corinthians 6 also.
Yep, it's in 2 Corinthians 6, 16. And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they shall be my people. So therefore,
that's good.
So, I mean, God's saying, you know, he's wanting to be, but we're the temple of God. We need to treat our bodies right. And I've come to the realization I'm not going to let anything, any earthly thing have control over me.
Yeah.
Food, smoking, alcohol, I mean, nothing. I'm not going to let that have control over me.
Yeah. And that's where, like, with my wife and I, even with casual drinking, you know, people have asked me before what my thoughts are on that. And for us, we chose to not do that because I want to be an example in everything, you know, and no matter what thoughts we have, you know, regarding one side or the other, the fact is, if somebody would happen to see Pastor Mac at a package store or a bar, immediately my voice as a godly figure in their life would be lowered in their respect.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be, for me, it's not worth it. You know, other people it may be, but for me it's not. And so, you know, really the same with smoking, but just ask the Lord. You know, that's what I want to tell. Is Jeff that his name?
Yes.
Jeff,
uh-huh.
Yeah. I want to tell you, man, just ask the Lord to help you, because it is something that's not good for you. It is something that controls, you know, because I've been there before. And ask God to help you, and his grace is sufficient to help you kick that habit. But you've got to give God something to work with.
Right.
Yep. That's good.
Yeah, it's good. That's good. And we thank Jeff for sending in a question. And if you have one you'd like to send in, you can email it to Mark at WVYN.org, and we'll read your question just like we did Jeff, and we'll have another one here in a moment. But if you want to call in, we invite you to call in. Mac and Corey would love to hear from you. Call in at 618-895-3030. 618-895-3030. We'll put you on the air, and we'll ask your question, or you'll ask the question to Pastor Mac and Corey, and they'll answer it for you. All right, 618-895-3030. It's our Ask the Pastor segment here on the Vine Morning Show. We'll do one more, guys, and we'll see if we get a call. If not, we'll ask this one here. This is from Gary, and he doesn't say where he's from, and that's fine. This is from Gary. He says, I heard a phrase the other day from a TV evangelist that my wife was watching that she recorded. Can you explain what dying to self means and where I can study that in the Bible? And that is from Gary. Thank you, Gary, for that question this morning, guys.
Yeah, I would say, did you have something first?
Well, Pastor Corey? We both got some different verses we talked about. The nice thing about the email questions is we can kind of read them and think
and
about it.
And get some scriptures, yeah.
But if you want to put us on the spot, call in. Yeah. You can kind of test us there. But 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I love these verses. It says, He died for all, talking about Jesus. For those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh. Yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That just kind of goes down to the essence of it is, you know, we have this, it's kind of like somebody cuts you off in the freeway or something. You know, this self, this flesh about me rises up. You know, you may want to shake your fist at them, or you may want to honk your horn, but you just kind of say, no, I'm not going to do that. Or old things used to be a part of. You know, Mac talked about smoking just a minute ago. That was something that he loved to do, something that he liked to do. It was a relaxing thing for him, but he come to Christ. The Holy Spirit dealt with him about it, and he said, no, I'm not going to live for myself any longer. I'm the temple of God. I'm going to step back from that. Christ died. Those things are gone. Everything's going to become new. And so dying to self is really just that, the selfishness that we all are really kind of born with. I mean, wouldn't you agree that we're all kind of born with a selfish nature?
Oh, yeah.
I haven't seen very many kids that really just want to share their stuff. They really kind of have to be taught to share.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I've got three. So I would say it's dying to that selfish nature that we're going to do what we want to do and how we want to do it. That goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden and say, no, we are a new creation. We are made in the image of God. Jesus Christ died for us, so we're going to die to ourselves.
Yeah, that's right. And I think it's really important to, like you said, to think dying to self. You know, what that means is denying that old person, you know, that the old way that you used to be, just like what you said in traffic, you know, that rising up. And that's why I think baptism, you know, the water baptism is important, mm-hmm. because it's symbolic of, you know, you're representing, let me word this, you're relating to Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And that's what you were saying has happened to you spiritually. Your old man, the old Mac, you know. I remember the day I was born again, May 1st, 1994, just down the road here in Wayne City. I gave my heart to the Lord. And that was the day that the old Mac died, you know. And I died to myself. And because of that, it just helps you when you look at yourself that way, because you're now alive in Christ. Mm-hmm. And when you look at yourself as the old person is dead, when those old things come up, like if you struggled with issues, you know, like lust, if you struggled with pride, if you struggled with anger, I want to even take it a step further. There are people who say divorce runs in my family. There are people who say sickness runs in my family. But when you're born again in Christ, you have a new family.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And no longer does divorce run in your family. That's no right. longer does anger problems. No longer does depression run in your family, because you are in the family of God. Mm-hmm. And He's promised you healing. And so guard, I don't know who this is for, but guard your mouth from that, because that's your natural family. But you've been born again and renewed by your Spirit into a new family, and all things have been made new and that's broken those generational curses, mm-hmm. those generational curses of alcoholism, those generational curses of anger, divorce, depression. All of those things are broken in Jesus' name. Yeah. And so if you struggle with that, I want to encourage you to find a Bible-believing pastor that'll pray over you also and just help you walk through that. But mm-hmm. Dying to self means that you don't let that old person raise up.
Right. And we've been kind of going back between 1 Corinthians 6 and 2 Corinthians 6. A lot of the similar things. But
yeah.
I love what it says in 1 Corinthians 6. I will not be mastered by anything.
Yes.
That's kind of what we're talking about.
What translation
about.
Is that?
That's just New International Version.
NIV. That's all I like.
But
that.
I will not be mastered by anything.
That's
and
good.
That is, you know, about the smoking, about the dying to self, about this. In context, he's saying, I will not be mastered by anything but Christ, by the word of God. I'm not going to let any earthly thing master me or master my body, you know, to control me. Sure. I'm not going to let it control me.
And that's another thing is, even going back to being a voice, when you realize that you're new in Christ and you deny yourself, that means denying your pride and you're being willing to put your neck on the line for standing for truth. Jesus said in Matthew 6:25, whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I like that because it's a different way of looking at that. And it's like, for his sake, you know, I deny myself. I'm dead to self. And so I'm going to go up and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with somebody because I'm not protecting myself. I'm not trying to guard my... you know what I mean?
I'm not going to let fear master me.
Yes,
I'm not going to let rejection control me. I'm not going to let addiction control me.
Jesus
is going to control. The Holy Spirit's going to fill me up and be my guide. You know,
man.
And we have to declare those things over ourselves.
Yes.
I believe that, and speak those things out loud and say,
yes.
you know, Jesus, I'm there. There's power in confessing.
Yeah.
The Bible says that.
Well, that's how you're born again. That's how the worlds were created.
Yes. So there's power in confessing that and saying, you know, I will not. Paul said it. I'm not going to be controlled by anything. I'm not, you know, I'm not going to let anything but Christ control me. I'm the temple of God. And so you have to kind of declare that over yourself and believe that and then walk in it.
Amen.
Amen. That's good. And again, that's Gary.
Thank you.
Good question, Gary.
Yeah, and thank you, Gary. We didn't get where you were from. You didn't put that in, but that's great. And we'll have some more questions here in a moment. Again, if you have a question for Pastor Mac or Pastor Cory, call us up at 895-3030 and we'll ask your question right on the air. And they'll give their best answer according to Scripture for you this morning. And anything on your heart you need to ask, please call in, 618-895-3030. And we'll come back in just a few moments with Pastor Cory and Pastor Mac right here on the Vine Morning Show. And right now it is time for Voice of the Martyrs, which is coming up next. And it's being underwritten by the Tin Shed in Wayne City. The Tin Shed in Wayne City invite you to celebrate Christmas in a small town holiday open house on Thursday, November 10th, 5:30 to 8:30 p.m. Friday, November 11th, 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Saturday, November 12th, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. And Sunday, November 13th, 12 noon to 4 p.m. They will have decor that will warm your heart and add beauty and charm to your Christmas displays. The Tin Shed, 701 West Robinson in Wayne City. Their phone number, 618-895-2155.
Hi, I'm Todd Nettleton, and this is the Voice of the Martyrs Radio. Pintu grew up in Bangladesh, believing Islam was the only true religion, but he felt empty inside. Curious, Pintu decided to learn about Christianity. When his family found out, they turned their backs. Pintu found comfort in the story of Joseph, whose brothers also abandoned him. One day, Pintu visited a church. The pastor was sharing a message on Joseph. At the end, Pintu rushed up and asked, "How do you know my story?" The pastor said, "I had another sermon prepared, but a voice told me to preach on Joseph instead. Now I understand it is because God had brought you here. You and I also have a God who pursues our hearts."
I will not let my brothers and sisters suffer in silence, nor will I let them serve alone. To join me in prayer for persecuted Christians, go to vomradio.net.
Me and my friends love the Vine.
90.9 The Vine.
Oh,
blessed multitude of your creation, rejoicing with our holy King, the only one that brings us all salvation. Victorious, we reign victorious over sin, over death, over all, over us. Victorious, we reign victorious, in your mighty name we trust. Let all proclaim you reign victorious. Victorious, we lift you above.
Radio 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine, victorious. We'll come back with Pastor Mac and Cory in a moment. More Ask the Pastor segment coming up on The Vine. But right now it's time for the Barrick Family Hope Out Loud, underwritten by Monroe County and McLeansboro.
Real Life Radio Foundation is blessed by the generosity of Monroe Accounting and McLeansboro. They specialize in a full line of accounting services for businesses, individuals, and farms, including tax preparation, payroll preparation, quarterly sales taxes, and more. Their office is located at 102 East Market Street in downtown McLeansboro, with experience and knowledge to serve your needs. Their phone number is 643-3993. Monroe Accounting in McLeansboro, a proud supporter of 90.9 and 105.5 The Vine.
Andy Barrick with today's Hope Out Loud.
Did you know that the phrase "do not be afraid" appears approximately 365 times in the Bible? That's once for every day of the year. Clearly, God doesn't want us to be afraid. But the Bible doesn't just tell us not to fear, it gives us the tools to be courageous. 1 John 4:18 tells us, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear." The perfect love of Jesus means that we don't have to worry about tomorrow, because no matter what trials this life brings, our Jesus will never leave us or forsake us. Dear Jesus, thank you for your perfect love that gives us courage to face each day.
Amen. Learn more about the Barrick family and their remarkable story at hopeoutloud.com.
It's 9:31, and we welcome you back here to the Vine Morning Show on this Thursday morning. I'm Mark. Great to have you along this morning, and we're in our Ask the Pastor segment with Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory this morning. Again, if you have a question, if you'd love to talk to the guys on the air, call us up at 618-895-3030. And we'll put you on the air, and you can ask them a question, and they'll answer it for you according to scriptures out of the Bible. If you have a question, something on your heart you need an answer for, or direction, call us up at 618-895-3030. Or you can email your question to mark@wvyn.org, and we'll ask your question on the air to Pastor Mac and Cory. And again, they'll do the same thing. They'll give you the best answer that they can according to the Word of God, all right? And if you have a question, again, if you want to talk to them on the air, call us up. They'll be glad to talk to you. That's what they're here for. They're here to help you, all right? Understand what may be going on in your life and you need an answer for direction, all right? 618-895-3030. And guys, we've got a couple more questions emailed in to us. Again, if you want to call us up and we'll interrupt the question and we can go back to it. And we'll put you on the air, okay? All right, guys, let's see. Let's move to this one here. This is from Richard, and he lives in Fairfield. And we thank Richard sending this one in this morning. His question is, I hear a lot of talk these days about Calvinism being compared to the Bible. Is there a difference, and is Calvinism biblical? That's, again, from Richard, and he's from Fairfield. Guys?
Well, this is a good question, yeah. And I guess to start out with, I'll kind of reference a question I answered last week. Mm-hmm. Somebody called about all the different denominations, and, you know, I said I really don't have a problem with the different denominations. I mean, this is what I look at. The Bible says God is clearly much higher than humans. His ways are not our ways. And really, he has revealed himself in his word, but there's an aspect of him that we just cannot comprehend. And yeah. So in these denominations, as long as we stick to the real biblical things, and they dealt with this in the book of Acts, they had to have a council at Jerusalem to say, look, all these Gentiles are coming in. What's the most important stuff? What are we going to hold to? And then what are some of the other things that we could disagree with and just be kind of cultural differences? So I look at Calvinism as is kind of the same way. It is a way that people have interpreted the Bible. And it goes back to John Calvin, which was a theologian around the time of the Reformation. Again, when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses on the church doors, John Calvin in the 1500s, he was a theologian and he wrote things. And so now a lot of people's biblical view is based on a lot of how he interpreted stuff, which is called Calvinism. The basic tenets are pretty simple. I mean, we were talking about this before. You know, I'd hate to oversimplify it because this can be a passionate debate. So again, what I'm telling you my view, and there are other pastors' views that will be different.
It depends on who, if you ask five people, you'll probably get five different views on it.
So, I mean, to come to the basics of how Calvinists view the Bible, and I don't want to oversimplify it, but they made an acronym with TULIP, correct?
Yeah.
So you've got it right there. So T would stand for total depravity, mm-hmm. which means that man is totally depraved. Mm-hmm. And they would go as far to say that man is so depraved that he could not choose God if God
didn't choose him first.
So you're so completely, totally depraved with a sinful nature that offered a choice in front of you of accepting the grace of God or continuing in your sin, you would be unable to make that choice, which leads to the U, which is
the unconditional election.
Unconditional election, which means that God unconditionally elects those who will be saved.
Right. That's what they believe.
This is Calvinism. Yeah. Okay, this is how they interpret scriptures. And they will have scriptural references that they say that lead to these things. Then goes to L, and this is the one I personally have the most struggle with, which is limited atonement, which means that Christ did not die for the sins of the whole world, but only for the sins of those that were elect. Mm-hmm. Which then goes to I, which is irresistible grace, which means if God did unconditionally elect you and his atonement was for you, that then this grace that would appear to you would be irresistible and you could not choose to reject it. It would be irresistible.
Yeah.
And then it goes to P, which is perseverance of the saints.
Which is once saved, always saved.
Which is, I mean, to boil it down, they wouldn't say that.
Yeah.
So, I mean, so Calvinism, I mean, that is a very, 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 how I just said it is very simple. Okay, I mean, there are volumes, theological volumes that deal with this.
Yeah.
I personally do not agree with it, but I have people that I love and that I care about that I know that are devout Christians that love the Word of God, that love the Lord with all their heart, that hold to this theological standard. They believe in evangelism. Some of the Calvinists, in fact, I know, they preach the gospel and witness to people a lot more than the other people.
Well, and I think even Calvinism has been like divided into hyper-Calvinism and straight Calvinism or something like that. Yeah.
So I will say there is an aspect, and it really boils down to, you know, with the sovereignty of God, of what there is an aspect of that I will be honest, that I do not comprehend, Pastor Mac, of God's sovereignty, of how God operates, of how God works,
and how
our choices affect that, and how they work into that. I cannot comprehend all of that because, again, God is bigger than that. And we could oversimplify, which is maybe a little bit the Arminianist view, know, which is kind of the other view, God sets this before
choice.
Us as a free choice. And so these are two different views in how we look at scripture.
Yeah. And I think, you know, that's what, because, you know, we had dealt with that very, very, strongly at our church,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it was a part of our some of our church, you know, back before I came. And just in looking at that, you know, people had talked and they said, you know, well, are you Calvinist? And I said, no, I personally don't embrace that doctrine. And they said, oh, well, then you're Arminian. And I said, no, I am Christian. I follow
right.
Christ,
right.
You know, and I follow him and his teaching. I don't embrace somebody's doctrine. I embrace the word of God.
Right.
And the word of God in John chapter 3, verse 16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Mm-hmm. And the sovereignty of God is something that I believe as mortal humans we cannot wrap our mind around.
No.
I think limiting God to one way or the other is limiting God.
Right.
And our minds try to put him in a box.
Right.
To try to, you know, theologically and you know, to try to grasp with our mind and figure God out.
Right.
And to put him in the bounds of a doctrine. And I think we need to be careful in doing that, because once you do that, it either gets you into fear or pride, and both are not good.
Mm-hmm. And so, you know, again, I think they're Calvinists. I know that love God, that love the Lord, and that, you know, they're my brothers and sisters in Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, they choose to describe some differently than I would.
Yeah.
I reject. You know, I mean, I don't mind saying that I do not hold the Calvinist view
right.
on things. I do personally do not. But I've read their books, and again, this is a very simple question, answer to it. I mean, a very simple answer to really a deep question.
It needs a long time to.
It needs a long time to really. I mean, we could talk about this for a month.
Yeah, but it's just a matter of that. Like, there's a lot of truth in it. But there's just some parts that I don't necessarily agree with, like the limited atonement. I believe that God doesn't halfway do things. You know, I believe that,
right.
that he fully and his Holy Spirit does draw us. It's our choice whether we choose salvation or not.
Right.
And it's not something forced upon us or you know, all of that. But, yeah, I think that's good. And I want to encourage you to you know, do some studies on it and,
right.
and look at it. You know, study the Word of God for yourself. One thing
that
I've always known and I've always said is you answer questions with the Bible from the Bible.
Right.
Look in the Word for questions about the Word. And
right.
Sometimes it's good to limit the voices that you have around
yeah.
you and go to the Word. Be a Berean.
Right. I guess ultimately I believe that God gives us a choice.
Yeah.
I don't believe God decided who would be. This is why I believe God gives us a choice. He tells us clearly, you know.
Yeah.
We have a choice. Going all the way back into the very beginning.
You can qualify it with the Old Testament.
Yes, you know, from the very beginning, a choice. We have a choice. You have a choice. What we talked about today, you know, we had a choice in the election. We have a choice today. Are we going to go witness to somebody? Or are we not going to? We have a choice to follow God, and God holds us accountable for those choices that we make with the information that we have.
And I think we can limit God to one path.
Right.
And the thing is when you look at the Israelites, it's very clear in the Old Testament, God said, if you follow me and do this, this will happen.
Right.
If you don't, this will happen.
Right.
Why can't we look at that in our walk with the Lord in salvation instead of saying, you know, these people God knows, and God does know everything. Mm. But you know, when you look at this, just like in the Old Testament, you know, it's like that. If you open your heart to receive the salvation as a gift from Jesus, you know, mm-hmm. and receive that and believe on him, then this will happen. If
right.
you don't, this will happen.
Right.
It's not that hard.
You know, 2 Peter 3, I love this verse. It talks about God's coming judgment and coming return. And it says, you know, some people think God's just not going to do what he said, but this is what Peter says: for God is not slack concerning his promise, but not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance.
Yeah.
So
Amen.
I believe God wants everybody to make the right choice.
Yes.
You know, but again, I heard one part of the denomination I'm part of stand up and say, "Look, it's not Arminianism, it's not Calvinism. Y'all need to quit arguing about it.
Yeah.
It's something that you're not going to grasp completely.
Exactly. Embrace Jesus Christ.
Embrace Jesus.
Every road has two ditches.
Yeah.
Find Christ in the middle.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Yeah.
So I hope that, I mean, I hope that's a fairly good answer.
A way it's to, just deep. To shorten something very deep.
Richard, we hope that Pastor Cory and Mac answered your question for you this morning. Give you some direction. All right. Thanks for sending that in. Again, 895-3030. If you have a question for Pastor Mac or Pastor Cory this morning, as it's our Ask the Pastor segment here on the Vine, still not too late to call. You can call us up at 618-895-3030. Something on your heart that you need direction, something you need some answer to, and you just don't know where to look. Pastor Mac and Cory will look in the Scripture for you and give you where you need to go and give you the best direction that you can have this morning. And that's what they're here for, all right? 618-895-3030. You can call in or email your question, mark@wvyn.org. Guys, we have another one that's been sent in to us, and here it is. My husband and I had a discussion recently on death and dying, and he was told we will face two judgments. Are we judged by God immediately after we die, or do we face judgment again when the rapture occurs? I listen online to your station through your app, and that's from Christine in Poseyville, Indiana, guys. And,
Poseyville, all right.
Thank you, Christine, for listening
online. That's
and
great.
Listening online through our app at wvyn.org. Thank you, Christine, for listening in Poseyville, Indiana. Guys, there's her question. Another good one.
Yeah, it really is. Pastor Cory and I were talking about that before because, you know, when you do die, you know, you leave this earth, it says, you know, to be absent from the body is to be present with Christ.
2 Corinthians 5:8.
Yeah, 2 Corinthians 5:8. And so, you know, that is, you know, where when you die, you go to heaven or hell.
But
that's
that.
That's not the eternal judgment, because there will be a time that you stand before God. Mm-hmm. And I'll just hand it over to you. You look like you're ready.
No, I mean, you are too. We both are. We talked about that. So I don't believe there are two judgments. You know, I believe that scripturally that you do go somewhere. I don't believe in soul sleep, or you go into the grave and you're just asleep. I think, you know, it's interesting. None of Jesus's parables had any names except for the rich man and Lazarus.
Yeah.
He named him. So there's a lot of there's some biblical scholars that believe that was not a parable.
It wasn't a parable,
but a real account.
Yeah.
And so they didn't, I guess, give the rich man's name for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
But
his family. Yeah.
But they did give Lazarus's name, which is interesting. So we see this account that they die, and one goes up and you know, to be comforted by God, and one goes into hell. 2 Corinthians 5:8. Let's read that. It says, "We are confident, yes, well pleased rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well pleasing to Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are all well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your consciences."
Yeah.
So Paul's saying that, you know, look, when we die, we're going to go to be with the Lord. If we're a follower of Christ, we're not going to go sleep in the grave.
Right.
We're going to go be in God's presence.
Yeah.
But there will come a time, and Paul also talks about this in Corinthians, that we will be judged, that what we have done in this earth, what we have done with what we have been given, just like the parable of the talents. Mm-hmm. You know, God's give us each something. Some of us have more, some of us have less. We're going to be judged on what we have done with what God has given us. And if we've wasted it, we're going to suffer loss in that judgment. If we have, you know, some people get this idea that when you go to heaven, and I don't believe this is scriptural at all, everybody's going to receive the exact same reward. That is not scriptural.
No, it's not.
If you have done well with what God, this is a management test. If you have managed well what God has given you, you will be rewarded in eternity. If you have not, then you will not be. Yes, we will all experience God's presence. Yes, that's part of the reward, that we will all be there with the Lord. But it's very scriptural that we will stand before a judgment. And I believe that's after everything wraps up, after everything goes. You had some verses in Revelation. I don't know if you were going to read those about that. But I don't believe in two judgments. I believe, you know, you will go somewhere, one place, but then you will also stand before
That's the judgment.
The Lord.
Yeah. And that's why even Paul, I think is in 1 Corinthians, and I'm sorry, I don't know the chapter and verse, but he talks about, you know, passing through the fire and what you build on the altar, which is Jesus Christ, that, you know, passing through the fire, whether it's gold or precious stones or, you know, wood, something that won't last through the fire, but you will make it through the fire. And but I love this. Like, here's some scriptures for you to write down to look at. Matthew 12:36. In Matthew 12:36, Jesus talks about that we'll give an account for the careless words that we say on the day of judgment. So we'll give an account for our careless words or idle words. 1 Corinthians 4:5 talks about the day of judgment.
Yeah.
Hebrews 9:27 says it's appointed once to die and then the judgment. And one that I wanted to read here is out of Revelations. This is holy, and this is this should put the fear of God in us, because it's okay to have the fear of God, and it's very important to have the fear of God in your heart, because that's what helps you to live holy. Mm-hmm. But here in Revelation 20:11, write that down. Revelation 20:11, it says, "Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works." Not, we'll say that, because a lot of times we say God knows my heart and we do bad works. But here, understand, we are judged according to the works, by the things which were written in the book.
Right. So again, it's not works that save you. Okay.
That's exactly right.
But you are going to be judged with what you how what you've managed done. With you know, with what God has given you. That is scripturally clear.
Yeah.
The verse you were talking about before is 1 Corinthians 3. Each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it. What day? Judgment day.
Yeah.
So I mean, to give you a glimpse, Revelation gives us glimpses into heaven. I believe that. The believers now are in heaven that have passed on.
It's holding.
They're waiting. It is not the eternal heaven. We talked about this before a while back.
Yeah.
It's not the eternal place. We would define heaven as where God is. So they are there with God. Yeah. They're there with Jesus Christ. It's a place, I'm sure, that is absolutely wonderful.
Yeah.
But they are waiting for the day of judgment. They're waiting for God to come and judge the earth. They're waiting before they will appear. And Christ is clear. They're up there waiting. There will be a judgment. God will give rewards. He will place, you know, if you have managed well, there will be things to be in charge of.
Yes.
We talked about this in eternity.
Things to do.
There will be cities to be in charge of. There will be work to do. There will be things to carry out. There will be awesome, incredible stuff. So I want to encourage you today. I don't think there's two judgments, but manage stuff well. So in eternity, you can be rewarded. I mean, that is scripturally clear.
Everything you do is eternal.
Yeah.
And so be mindful of the eternity minded, you know, that you affect eternity and you'll stand before God. I mean, it is very clear.
What a petty thing to let our fear get in the way, or our discomfort, or our stuff to get in the way from doing kingdom work.
Yeah.
When there are eternal rewards to have.
Exactly.
I mean, we're really no better off than the person that doesn't save for retirement here in this life and go blows their money on lottery tickets or something. You know what I mean?
I do want to say something, though, because I've been met with this question when we've talked about the subject at our church before. Someone said, well, then will we stand before God to answer for our sins?
No.
Exactly. That's right. You're right. Because the blood of Jesus washes away our sins.
Right.
We stand as a believer before God to give an account for what we've done on this earth as a believer.
Right. Yeah. Well, how we've managed.
Yeah. And so, I mean, you know, if you're forgiven, we're not saying that you're going to stand before God and receive judgment for your sins because the blood of Jesus
washes
away your sins.
Those things aren't
going
to be brought up. You're not going to have to stand up there and God's going to look at you and say, well, you know, on November, what is today, the 10th? On November 10th, why did you say this or do this or you do? That's not going to happen.
Exactly.
But I do believe. Again, it's not what saves you, your works, but you will be judged as a believer.
And idle words. You're going to be held accountable for the
I believe there's another judgment seat for those that are not.
Yeah.
They're judged in a different standard because they don't have the blood of Christ covering them. And then they will be cast out for eternity, which is a scary thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, that is good stuff.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah, you guys answered that really well. Again, that was from Christine, listens on our smartphone app. In Poseyville, Indiana.
Yeah, thank you, Christine.
Yeah, thanks. So, hey, we're going to come back. It's that time. We're going to be wrapping it up, guys, here in a moment. We'll come back and get some final thoughts from Pastor Mac and Pastor Cory here on the Vine Morning Show. More to come. Laura Greathouse and her program, Keeping Watch, on the way It is coming up right here at The Vine.
Real Life Radio is thankful for the financial partnership we have with Greenwald & Sons Construction in Wayne City and in Mount Vernon. They specialize in residential and commercial construction and remodeling. They have a long list of satisfied customers spanning over 38 years. Whether it's a church addition, business expansion, or new home construction, Greenwald & Sons Construction of Wayne City and Mount Vernon are experts that you can depend on. Their phone number is 895-2044, and we thank them for their support of local Christian radio.
Shoe Creek Pharmacy is your good neighbor pharmacy in downtown Wayne City. Consultations are available on all prescriptions and over-the-counter medications. They are open Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and on Saturdays from 9 a.m. until 12 noon. Their phone number is 895-2844. Shoe Creek Pharmacy, 310 South Main Street, downtown Wayne City.
Real Life Radio is grateful for the underwriting support of Taylor Flooring in Mount Vernon. Located at 328 Main Street in Mount Vernon, Taylor Flooring specializes in the sales, service, and installation of top brands such as Mohawk, Southwind, and LW Mountain. 100% locally owned and operated by Mark and Sherry Taylor, Taylor Flooring in Mount Vernon has your flooring needs covered. Their phone number is 315-6004. He who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is Keeping Watch with Laura Greathouse.
I would like to read a report to you from some recent polls that have been taken from a message given by Dr. Mark Hitchcox. His title was Apocalypse in the Air. Mr. Hitchcox said, "This title is a practical reason why Bible prophecy is important now. Because people everywhere are thinking about end times, and Christians must be equipped as people are sensing we are getting near the end." A recent poll showed 41% of secular America, not Christians, secular America believes end times have arrived. 77% of evangelicals and 54% of Protestants agree the world is currently in the end of time as described as prophecy in the Bible. A recent poll from Nashville's Lifeway Research found 1 in 3 Americans see conflict in Syria as part of the Bible's plan for the end. 1 in 4 believe a U.S. airstrike in Syria could lead to Armageddon. And this one to me was the most incredible. Polls show that 1 in 5 believe the world will end in their lifetime. Remember, this is America's public. This is not a Christian poll. As you can see, Dr. Hitchcox is correct in saying, when the feeling is that great around our nation, the church has a responsibility to move in and answer that need. End time talk, some pastors won't allow it because they believe it chases people off. End time talk is often not something that will fill the pews. But the Christians must know what's ahead, because when it all starts falling apart, it's going to be us the world is looking at and asking the questions.
This has been Keeping Watch with Laura Greathouse, heard twice daily on 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine.
All right. As we get ready to wrap things up here this morning, guys, you know, it seems like when you guys are here, it's like we blink our eyes twice and, oh, it's over with.
It goes quick.
It goes fast.
It goes fast. But, again, we thank those that sent in email questions in. And, again, you can email your questions to mark at wvyn.org anytime during the week. But, again, we like to hear from you. You can call us up on the phone, too.
Yeah.
We'll do this again next Thursday, guys. And any final thoughts today, guys, on what we talked about? Corey, you want to start?
Or? Well, you know, just be – don't let anything control you but the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And I think it's got to be both. Yeah, you know, some people, sure, they get one or the other. And it's got to be the Word and the Spirit controlling you and moving in you. And don't be afraid to be the church outside the walls. Mm-hmm. We have got to do that.
Yeah.
We have got to be outwardly focused. We have got to be focused on winning one at a time. You know, winning that person for Jesus, letting them know that God cares about them and loves them and died for them. And You know, I said Sunday morning, the cross of Christ shows us, it's such an awesome picture of God's love for humanity, but also his judgment for sin.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
At the same time. At the same time. And we have to let that motivate us to tell people about the Lord.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's what we're doing at New Beginnings, and that's what I encourage people to do every week. And we got church on Sunday. Sunday school starts at 9. Service starts at 10. You need a ride, we'll pick you up. 618-842-3683. Call and let us know so we can put you on the list to come get you. But we love you and we love Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. 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 And you got the packing party for OCC coming up,
that's
right?
That's coming up. I know your church is big into that.
Yeah.
Operation Christmas Child. And you know what? An awesome way to make a difference and a kid's life and let them know that God loves them. And so we've got this packing party coming up. It's this Sunday. We're packing the shoe boxes together, so awesome. We're excited about it. And then we'll be taking them over to House of Prayer because that's the collection point.
Yes, right? That's right.
So if you want to get involved, tell them about how they can do that.
Mark, with the Operation Christmas Child things, we're dedicating this Sunday the ones that we packed last week.
That's right.
And then this coming week, we're going to be collecting
starting Monday, 14th. All the way through the following Monday.
Yeah. And so if you look online at thehop.org, we'll have the information also on our Facebook page.
Sweet.
The times that we have it available, we're going to be ribbon cutting, opening it up Monday morning. I want to encourage you because it doesn't cost a lot to put even just one box together, and that's what through Operation Christmas Child,
one child is saved
every 30 seconds.
Wow. Isn't that an amazing thing?
What a good way to invest.
It's very important. But and at the House of Prayer, doing great over there. We've got our family nights on Wednesday. We have a meal at 5:15 and Royal Rangers Impact Girls for your kids, grades kindergarten through 12. And then we've got a adult Bible study for our adults starting at 6:30. It all wraps up at 7:30. We have home groups. Our home groups have been growing. Small groups at our church and at different people's house Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday and Thursdays. So we'll have that online also. Sunday morning service at 9 a.m. If you're looking for a church and you're close to our area, come out to House of Prayer. If you're in the Fairfield area, go to New Beginnings. Two great churches to be a part of. We preach the Word of God and follow the Holy Spirit. The Word and the Spirit together.
The Word and the Spirit, you got to have both.
Making an explosive force for God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Guys, thanks for coming in. What a lot of fun we have on Thursdays here at the Vine.
Amen.
And we appreciate both churches as well. So thanks for coming in. Hey, tomorrow morning is Fun Day Friday on the Vine. Jimmy will join me in the studio, and Kelly's not going to be able to be here tomorrow. She has a commitment. So tomorrow morning is the debut of the newest Vine intern.
Yeah, guys. That's great.
I'm going to tell you if it's male or female. You can go to our Facebook page, Real Life Radio 90.9 The Vine, and you'll read about it right there. And then there's two eyeballs that stare at you. And you got to figure out, okay, is this a male or a female?
Mm-hmm.
But this person's going to debut. Never been on the air with us before.
All right.
So this is going to be fun tomorrow, and we'll have a movie theme song this week and a Friday riddle. We'll have some cool prizes to give away. It's Fun Day Friday. We're always in the week on a positive note. So Jimmy and the newest Vine intern will join us tomorrow morning right here on the Vine Morning Show. It'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, so that'll be good.
Tune in and find out. A lot of people will know this person, and tune in and find out who it is coming up tomorrow morning here on the Vine. And we'll kick it off at 6:30 tomorrow morning, right after Focus on the Family. Beautiful day. Yeah, you guys liking this weather. Mac, you said you like it. Cory, what about you? You're loving this weather, right?
Yeah, it's awesome.
It is, isn't it? Yeah, 64 the high. Clear tomorrow, high of 60. And then Sunday, clear as well. 54 on Saturday, 60 on Sunday, and then Monday starting the week, partly cloudy, high of 62. Don't forget, coming up later on tonight, Pastor Rob Greenwald in the Orchardville Church, his sermon tonight. Right here on 105.5 and 90.9 The Vine. And Jenny Lee is next with The Overflow. She'll have that from 10 to 2. And then Brian, he'll be in later on tonight at 6 with the Soul Shine. And then before that, Jimmy Bass, the afternoon matinee. Have a great day, everyone. And always remember to read Scripture daily. Stay focused on God and His Word. Again, coming up, Jenny Lee and The Overflow coming up right here on The Vine.